If 1944 was the year last week when we talked about Phantom Lady, Laura, or Double Indemnity, this week we turn our heads to 1946, an equally epic year in which Gilda, which we discussed on Monday, and today's film were released. The Postman Always Rings Twice, directed by Tay Garnett, and based again on a novel by James Malachan Kane, is another classic film noir, and for me, one of my absolute favorites.
I've been waiting a long time for that kiss.
When we get home, Frank, then there'll be kisses. The kisses with dreams in them. Kisses that come from life, not death.
I hope I can wait.
The Postman Always Rings Twice has almost all the key components that made film noir what is most recognized for. We have archetypical characters such as another great femme fatale. We have the classic chiaroscuro photography. We have flashbacks, voiceovers, a crime, firecracking chemistry, and fatalism. It is an absolute pleasure to talk about The Postman Always Rings Twice, as in this case, I have also read the novel, and needless to say, this is my favorite adaptation. Funnily enough, yet again, we have another MGM production, which is proving to be quite a constant in this Noirvember challenge, and not so much a curiosity. There were two previous adaptations of the novel made in Europe, one in France, released in 1939, and another loose adaptation by Luchino Visconti called Ossessione in Italy. So this was in fact not the first adaptation, but the third, as these two European productions precede The Postman Always Rings Twice, produced by MGM. There is yet again a fourth adaptation, as many of you would know, released in 1981 with Jessica Lange and Jack Nicholson. But for me, the classic, the version that I've seen the most, is 1946, The Postman Always Rings Twice. The plot, once again, much like Double Indemnity, another Malachan Kane novel, features a couple plotting and then murdering the woman's husband for different reasons. In this case, because it's an obvious impediment for them to be together. What I love most about this movie, that I also did love about the novel, is eminently the characters. As it happens in many film noirs, as we've seen, it's that component of fatality, of characters doomed from the get-go, a destiny that cannot be escaped no matter how hard you try to take the right road. In this case, it's a character of Frank Chambers, played wonderfully by John Garfield, that is branded by calamity. The key, I think, precisely of this film adaptation relies heavily on John Garfield's, especially, and also Lana Turner's performance. He does a tremendous job here in playing a very believable man who is desperately attracted by Cora Smith and who falls for her even though he tries to escape her. I read though that Joel McRae was considered first for the part of Frank Chambers, but to be honest, even though I love Joel McRae, I think that John Garfield is the perfect choice here. He was an actor from New York who had worked in the theater, and he brought much authenticity and a fresh new way of acting, I think, to Hollywood. It is not so much what he does here as with many of the male protagonists that we see in film noirs, but his attitude, his posture, and the man he becomes and he is able to convey so vividly. His performance, yet again, is quite essential to make this movie work, because it is told from his point of view. Even though female characters, like in the case of Gilda, really take a lot of the allure and fascination from these movies. It is precisely the parts that men play that have to be extra convincing in order for that formula to be successful. Lana Turner also, who, to be perfectly honest, is not one of my favorite actresses, but I think that here their chemistry is on fire and they both gave one, I think, of their best performances. Just her appearance in the white outfit and the white turban, it is one of the quintessential entrances of femme fatales in classic film noir. I'd say this one and that of Jane Greer in Out of the Past, also funnily enough, is wearing white. In this movie, Lana Turner does wear white for the majority of the movie, and you can really tell that it is an MGM production in this case, precisely by the way Lana Turner is groomed and dressed in this film. It is an image of the character of Cora Smith that differs somewhat from the picture we get from the book, but it plays out really well, and it is fantastically counterbalanced by Joan Garfield. James Mallahan Caine considered her the best actress to play that part. The movie in this case, much like with This Gun for Hire, was directed by a veteran filmmaker whose career also stemmed from silent movies, and without a string of characteristic titles linked to his name. The adaptation of the novel was in this case by Harry Ruskin and Niven Bush, also a novelist and a screenwriter whose book Duel in the Sun was also adapted for the screen. At that time, he was married to the fantastic actress Teresa Wright, who would act in Pursuit, a noirish western with a screenplay precisely written by him. It is quite a cult movie with great admirers such as Martin Scorsese and myself. Cinematography in this case was by yet again another veteran from MGM, a man that in fact had spent most of his career in that studio and who had also started in silent movies. Much like the case of John Garfield, he sadly passed much too soon, in fact just a year later from the release of The Postman Always Rings Twice. The visuals of this movie incorporate that Hollywood glamour that differs from movies we've seen such as Union Station, The Asphalt Jungle, or even Act of Violence, more in tune with Italian neorealism, with a more realistic, gritty look. But I'd say that it plays in favor, in my opinion, of The Postman Always Rings Twice, because one of the things that I love the most, again, about this movie is how it all plays out in the end. And that fatality that I was alluding to, that feeling that it seems that the character is about to get away with everything and then his luck changes because we're in a film noir, and they're like, hold on, karma is coming to you. And is the reaction that John Garfield has to all of this that I absolutely love. This movie is certainly remembered today for one of the most sultry and sexy female characters in film noir, but we have to say that in the book that attraction is even more blunt. Of course, since it's 1946, Hays Code was in place and they had to work around all that, but still the seduction game, the attraction, is jaw-dropping in some instances. The Postman Always Rings Twice firmly represents what makes film noir so vivid, so absorbing, and so relevant nowadays. A movie and a novel that, as I said in the beginning, are one of my absolute favorites, so much so that in fact I read The Postman Always Rings Twice once a year. So it is definitely one that I truly, truly recommend. If you haven't watched this film adaptation yet or read the novel, I highly, highly encourage you to do so. So that's all I have for you for today's video. I always find it difficult to talk about the movies that I like because I always get the feeling that all I do is ramble. But in any case, it's because, again, I love them. So I hope as always that you enjoyed it. Thank you so much for watching. Thank you so much for joining me for this film noir challenge. Thank you so much for sharing the love for classic movies. I hope that you stay safe, that you take care. So again, much love. See you tomorrow. Thank you so much. Bye.